morning, everyone. I'm Richard Newell. I'm the president of Resources for the Future. I want to welcome you to this Policy Leadership Forum. For those of you who are not familiar with RFF, we're a nonprofit research institution located here in Washington, D.C. Our mission is to improve environmental, energy, and natural resource decisions through impartial economic research and policy engagement. The Policy Leadership Forum is a series of events that we've had over the years that hosts leading national and international thinkers to discuss energy and environmental and natural resource topics. In the past, we've had speakers such as Hosung Lee, the chair of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, EPA Administrator Gina McCarthy, Treasury Secretary Hank Paulson, and Senator Barack Obama. Today, we're delighted to welcome Dr. Marcia McNutt, the 22nd president of the National Academy of Sciences, for this Policy Leadership Forum to explore crucial questions about evidence-based decision-making. Dr. McNutt is a geophysicist. Previously, before her service at the National Academy of Sciences, she was editor-in-chief of the journal Science from 2013 to 2016. Dr. McNutt was the director of the U.S. Geological Survey from 2009 to 2013, during which time the USGS responded to a number of major disasters, including the Deepwater Horizon oil spill. For her work to help contain that spill, Dr. McNutt was awarded the U.S. Coast Guard's Meritorious Service Medal. She's a fellow of the American Geophysical Union, the Geological Society of America, the American Association for the Advancement of Science, and the International Association of Geodesy. She is a member of the American Philosophical Society and the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, and a foreign member of the Royal Society of the United Kingdom and the Russian Academy of Sciences. You can find out more about Marcia's remarkable career in the program at your seat. Believe it or not, this is just a sprinkling of her many accomplishments. Hopefully you've also received a Q&A card as you entered the room. Staff members will be collecting those during the event and will be asking Dr. McNutt as many of the questions as we can during our time today, during the last portion of the event. For those of you joining us online, you can use hashtag AskRFF, that's A-S-K-R-F-F, on Twitter to ask any questions. I'm honored to serve on the National Academy of Sciences Board on Environmental Change in Society, and I've participated in many National Academy studies over the years, so I can testify firsthand the tremendous treasure that we have in the National Academies and its incredible legacy of contribution to the nation. So with that, I'm pleased to welcome Dr. Marcia McNutt, President of the National Academy of Sciences, to the stage.
Well, thank you very much, Richard, for that very long and generous introduction. It's really a pleasure to be here today. I never tire of talking about the importance of using evidence in decision making, because I really don't think there is any better way to make decisions than really using evidence and the scientific method. And let me sort of walk you through my thinking in that. So let's begin here. Here's the main building of the National Academy of Sciences in a blow-up of the Albert Einstein statue, which sits in front of it. And the National Academy of Sciences was founded by Abraham Lincoln during the Civil War. And we are unique, actually, among scientific academies worldwide, in that our founding was not simply to be an honorific society to celebrate esteemed scientists, but it actually, the founding of the National Academy was because Lincoln, in his brilliance, felt there was a need to assemble the brightest minds in the country to advise the government. And this was during the darkest days of the Civil War, and he wanted smart people to give evidence-based advice to government on how to win the war. And that persists as the main reason why the National Academy exists to this very day. So the questions that I want to address today is, does it matter to pay attention to science? And then, if it does matter, why do we still see science being ignored? So, of course, I'm going to say, yeah, it does matter to pay attention to science. And let me just give you, I mean, I could go on for hours here about why it does, but let me just give you two examples. One is, some of you here, a few of you, not everyone, probably remembers the day when you would fly on airplanes and there was smoking on airplanes. There was a smoking section and a non-smoking section. And you didn't have to be a rocket scientist for some people to raise their hands and say, yeah, but all the air is recirculated on planes. And so why have a non-smoking section when all of the air is being recirculated? And once the dangers of secondhand smoking became apparent, health advocates said, we're all breathing the same air, and if there's a smoking section, we're at risk as well. And so the health advocates got the government to ask the Academy to consider the question, should smoking be banned entirely on airplanes for the health of citizens? So the National Academy took this matter up. But in the Academy's usual very careful way of looking at the question, they put on the panel not just health advocates, but people who knew about airplanes and people who knew about all the aspects of how airplanes were constructed. And what they found was that during the flights of airplanes, little pinprick holes would develop in the pressurized compartments of aircraft. And it was only the tar and nicotine from cigarettes that plugged the pinprick holes in the passenger compartment that kept them pressurized at altitude. And if smoking was banned completely from airplanes, they would decompressurize. So the Academy, in its wisdom, suggested a phased approach to banning smoking on airplanes to allow the aircraft industry an opportunity to improve the quality control in the pressurized compartments in airplanes and find a solution to the pinpricked holes so that people could safely fly in non-smoking airplanes without losing pressurization at altitudes. And now we all fly very safely at altitude in non-smoking airplanes without losing our oxygen. So evidence does matter in making decisions. Now here's another example where evidence was ignored. The Spanish flu, widely believed to have been the worst pandemic in human history. Something like 20 to 40 million people were believed to have died during that global pandemic. It happened during World War I. It was a highly contagious disease. The military came to the National Academy and asked for advice about how to protect the US Army troops. The Academy recommended not housing troops in close quarters because of how contagious the disease was. The military rejected the Academy's advice, saying, that is not the military way. We're the military, we put our troops in barracks. The flu affected 20 to 40% of US troops, and there was a higher mortality rate from the flu than from enemy fire. So this was a case where the advice was rejected and it had consequences. Okay, so fast forward to today. Last year, Oxford Dictionaries had as their word of the year, post-truth. And I think scientists are feeling this, that they are under siege, that scientific evidence and the currency that we provide no longer has as much credibility in decision making. And there's general angst in the scientific community that science advice is not being listened to. So what's the root cause of this? Well, in trying to come up with a visual, how many of you are familiar with the game Jenga? Lots of people, good, I'm happy to see that. Okay, it's a game where you stack up a lot of wooden blocks, or wooden these wooden blocks, and make a big tower, and then the job is to sort of see how they're kind of leaning and see which ones you can pull out without the tower falling down. So I sort of imagine science as having, when people say, do people trust science? I want to distinguish science as three different elements. And the three different elements I want to talk about are distinctly science as the scientific method, individual studies, and scientific consensus. So the scientific method I view as something that is pretty ironclad, that scientists, as well as non-scientists, are fairly confident in the scientific method as the proven self-correcting approach for revealing the laws governing the natural world. No one has yet to come up with a better method for understanding how the natural world works than the scientific method. That is the foundation for everything we do. That is the bedrock upon which we build everything we do in evidence-based work. But now the individual studies are like these individual Jenga blocks. Scientists don't really necessarily trust an individual study. Any individual study may be okay, it may be not okay. Some may have not have gone through peer review yet. Some may have gone through peer review and later be overturned. Some may be retracted. Some may not stand the test of time. They're like these Jenga blocks. They may be pulled out and shown that they were unnecessary, or they may be wrong, or they may be superfluous because the scientific consensus doesn't need them, okay? But the scientific consensus up here is built upon a bulwark of individual studies. And the scientific consensus will not stand unless it has a number of individual studies that support it. And if too many of them are pulled out because they are either overturned or found to be faulty, then the scientific consensus will also topple. And we call that a paradigm shift. If too many of them are pulled out and the scientific consensus falls, then we have to replace it with some new scientific consensus. So sometimes scientific consensuses will stand the test of time and they become fairly eternal. Sometimes they need slight revisions, like the law of gravity of Newton got revised by Einstein. But it was a revision that for the common man was not all that important. So that's my kind of view. So when we talk about do we trust science, we have to make a distinction. Are we talking about the scientific method? Are we talking about an individual study or the scientific consensus? Most of us as scientists are very reverent about the scientific consensus, not at all about individual studies. We very much trust the scientific method. Okay, so, there we are. So, public skepticism. Where does public skepticism come from? Sometimes the public questions science because they don't distinguish the results of individual studies from the scientific consensus. So individual studies can be all over the board. A good example is, coffee's good for you, coffee's bad for you. You know, these a lot of studies in some areas can be all over the board. And I just pulled these off the internet. Coffee and diabetes. Did you know coffee is good for you? The coffee controversy. 9 tips to quit for good. You know, I mean, and when you say coffee is good for you, what do you mean by good and who is you? And so if you don't define what you mean by good and who you is, the answer can be very different. Very different. So that's the problem, and that's why the public can be skeptical, because good is not defined and you is not defined. Now, here's other reasons why science is ignored, and this is what I want to sort of end with here. Science is ignored when no practical solution is available. So we may have some science, but the public feels like, yeah, but I don't know what to do with the science. I got a problem, here's the science, but there's no solution. The classic example was the delay in the Montreal Protocol. Now, the Montreal Protocol banned CFCs to heal the ozone. But the history of that was scientists were saying for years that chlorofluorocarbons were destroying the ozone and the ozone hole was growing. There were those in industry, largely, the refrigerant industry, who was saying, oh, we don't think the science is settled. Oh, that science is not good. Oh, we need to study that some more. Well, we can't really do away with refrigerants because people need their refrigerators and they need their hairspray and blah, blah, blah. Meanwhile, the people in the refrigerant industry were working madly in their labs to come up with a replacement for chlorofluorocarbons. And the day that DuPont came out with the replacement such that the little pink can or whatever was replaced by the little yellow can that was the same size, the same shape, and could go in the same place in your refrigerator, they suddenly said, oh yeah, the scientists were right. This is a problem. And the Montreal Protocol was signed overnight. And DuPont made zillions of bucks selling the little yellow can instead of the little pink can. And the ozone hole is now healing. And so the important thing here is that evidence might be there, but unless there's a practical solution, the science will be ignored. So this is an important thing. Another issue is when the science is not presented as actionable with respect to the problem. And this happens all the time. So you know, not to maybe, you know, give any specific example, I just decided to make up one. My home is in Monterey County, California, and Monterey has been struggling with the idea of whether or not to allow fracking. The rocks in the Monterey Formation are very oil rich. And, but, you know, difficult to get out. It's not a typical oil reservoir. And there are those in the area who would like to get the oil out of the Monterey Formation, and many who would like to prevent oil development. So the question is, should it be allowed? Well, in studying that, if the science is presented based on experience in Pennsylvania, that would not be science that's actionable with respect to the problem, because the water situation and the potential for earthquake generation is so different in California than Pennsylvania that it would not be presenting the science as actionable with respect to the situation in Monterey County, California, where the San Andreas Fault goes right through the county, and the water situation is one of water scarcity rather than water plenty. Okay, and then there's the issue when science can be ignored because the results conflict with deeply held biases. And this one we see all the time. The National Academies of Science, Engineering, Medicine put out a report right before the 2016 election on the economic the effect of immigration in America. The bottom line was that immigrants don't steal your jobs and they don't increase crime in America. Well, have we seen this as the general top line from the current administration in terms of their immigration policy? Well, no. And the reason is that those top lines don't play to what is widely held views of many Americans. And here's what the report is. The economic and fiscal consequences of immigration. That's the name of the report. And there are a pair of reports. One is the integration of immigrants into American society. And the report basically found was immigration has overall positive impact on economic growth, innovation, and entrepreneurship. They contribute positively to the federal budget, but can be a drain at the state and local levels. So there are positive and negative impacts. So let me just end by saying that science without policy is still science, but policy without science is gambling. So thank you.
If folks have questions that you haven't gotten to somebody yet, just write them down on your card and wave it, and somebody will come collect it. That was very great remarks, Marcia. Want to delve into one particular question. So top scientific journals, including economic journals, have increased their expectation for data availability, for replication, and for validation. Following an April EPA proposal on transparency and regulatory science, there's been debate about what is reasonable to expect in terms of data transparency and methods transparency for important scientific studies that underpin major regulatory decisions. This includes how we trade off the benefits of transparency with, you know, concerns about privacy. So help us sort through this issue.
Right. So when I was editor-in-chief at Science, as you mentioned, Science was one of the journals leading the charge towards more openness and transparency in the requirements for authors to make available their data, their methods, their code, their materials. But they always had the option and made sure that there were exemptions in the case of personal privacy. Mainly those were cases for things like patient records, cell phone data, things like that, where there would be the fear that releasing the original data would compromise personal privacy. And journals put in place the procedures that would allow the reviewers to make sure that they could get access to the information in a way that they could validate the author's findings and conclusions, and that the owners of the data could make available the original data under the same non-disclosure terms or whatever that the original authors had for purposes of replication of the studies. But it stopped short of the open release of the data. So the journal editors felt that this was a reasonable route to, on one hand, having policies for open data, open methods, open materials and code, but still protecting privacy. So if journals can do it, we don't see a reason why, for example, the EPA policy couldn't make a good public policy while still protecting privacy.
There was a commission last year, I believe it was the Commission on Evidence-Based Policymaking, that put forward some recommendations for a national data service, I think it was called. Have you followed that at all? Because it had some similar recommendations where the federal government could set up a system by which administrative records and other records could be made available for generation of evidence to underpin decision making, but do so in a means that protects privacy rights.
I don't know. Right. Well, I do think that protection of privacy is good. The other thing I do know is that there is always going to be a struggle with how to pay for all of these mandates to make data available. So I do like to hear that the government is thinking seriously about how to afford these mandates for data availability. One thing that I think should also be kept in mind is that there are really well-run data repositories right now that are specific to certain fields and disciplines that shouldn't be messed with and shouldn't be folded into some general national data service. I think a general one is fine for, say, data that have no other place to go, but the well-run discipline-specific data services, they may need a little extra support, but I don't think that they should be folded into any big government.
Right, yeah. I don't know if we have any questions yet from... Very much. Yeah, interesting question. So resources for the future is focused principally on economics as an approach and other social sciences toward decision making. Do you see a distinction between the use of and the demand for and reaction to natural science evidence relative to social science evidence in decision making?
Wow, that's a really good question. So I do think it depends on the specific issue, because really well done studies, I find, are respected no matter what the field, whether it is in biology, physics, social sciences, no matter what. And let me just give a couple examples. I think the world paid homage to LIGO and the, you know, first of all, the endurance of the LIGO team, but the beauty and sophistication of that experiment. But there are other examples of studies in the natural sciences, the environmental sciences, and even in the social sciences that have been done with beauty and precision that I think people really like. I think more the problem is when, and this was on one of my slides, when the results conflict with people's deeply held biases, that's when people naturally want to reject the conclusions. And that is more likely to happen in the social sciences and some areas of the environmental sciences. So there can be an experiment in climate science or an experiment in social sciences that if people don't like the results, it has to be done 10 times better than a study in physics, say, or chemistry, for people to be respectful of it.
Yeah, one of the challenges also in social science is often the lack of a controlled experiment where you're dealing with human behavior and understanding human behavior, and so some of the methodological challenges are also.
Well, that's the same problem with climate. We don't have our control Earth for climate, and I think that is exactly the same problem.
There's various ways that different parts of society gauge the credibility and role of evidence and evaluate the quality and degree to which that evidence should enter in decision making. And there's, if you look across society more broadly, there isn't necessarily a uniform standard. So science and academics tend to use the scientific method and the peer-reviewed journal publication process. The U.S. legal system has rules of evidence about what can enter into, and rules and legal principles that govern the role of facts in legal proceedings and the admission of scientific evidence and expert testimony. The rules and norms around what should count as evidence in policy decision making are a little bit more up for grabs and nuanced. Sometimes there's also a tendency for simple litmus tests like follow the money, where did the money come from? And that is the metric by which I judge whether something should enter in rather than the scientific merits of a particular study. So how do you think about this, and what can we do to develop a better shared understanding of what kind of evidence should enter into our decision making?
That is a really great question. So, Anne's sitting here on the front row, and she probably remembers this study well. I think that we have to become, especially in very controversial topics, far more concerned about real and perceived conflicts of interest when it comes to decision making in the public sphere. And one example I'll use, because I think the committee took this problem very seriously and went out of their way to be transparent about how they handled it. And this was the study that the National Academies did on the safety of genetically modified organisms. And this was a very thorough analysis of all of the work, a considerable body of research that had been done, pro and con, on the safety of mostly food, genetically modified. And they started with a literature review, and they looked at, to the extent that it could be determined, for every study, who funded the study? Was it funded by the federal government? Was it funded by an industry organization that does genetic modification? Was it funded by an organization that is an anti-GMO lobbying organization, or a organization that is committed to non-GMO products, et cetera? And they annotated their reference list with showing which of these studies might have a perceived bias one way or another. And they looked to what extent any of the authors had a history of funding from one side or the other. And they based their conclusions only on studies that they felt were as neutral as possible, because the funding didn't come from either one side or the other. And the study actually came to different conclusions than previous work that had used all of the literature. So I thought that was actually an interesting result.
Very interesting. We have a question here about the role of insights from cognitive science and behavioral science on the improving the effectiveness of science communication. Is this something that the NAS has been involved in? Or
yes, the NAS has had a whole series of colloquia on the science of science communication, because there actually is a whole field of researchers who look at science communication as a field of inquiry. And how do we communicate science? And so many of the natural things that we think we should do are actually wrong and are actually counterproductive. And for example, as many of you in this audience know, because this is a pretty savvy group here, the importance of storytelling in science communication, of not telling people the theory and the details of something, but actually just giving them a story about something as being the bedrock of science communication. So these colloquia have been some of the most popular ones we've had at the Academy.
But following up on this a bit, so in a democracy, you know, the role of science and evidence in decision making is ultimately going to depend upon the degree to which voters insist that decision making is based at, on evidence. As you pointed out in your presentation, there can often be cognitive dissonance, particularly if there's deeply held beliefs or if some evidence just doesn't coincide with a basic belief or what somebody thinks is fact. So what can we do? You talked a little bit just now about what you're doing on the communication of science, but what else can institutions like the NAS or like RFF that really value the role of evidence decision making, what can we do to kind of improve this, the degree of validity and importance that voters place on evidence and decision making.
So again, back to your previous question on science communication, I think that leads right into this, because one of the issues from science communication is that there are sort of two axes to effective communication. One is competence, and the other is trust. And if you want to communicate effectively, it's important that the audience sees you as being both competent in what you're talking about and trustworthy. Because if you're viewed as competent but not trustworthy, they're not going to really necessarily want to tune in to what you're saying. And most, a lot of the scientists end up coming across as, in fact, most scientists come across as very competent, but not necessarily trustworthy. Because trust is a human quality that implies some warmth. And unfortunately, scientists, all of the training we have, and how many of you are scientists here? Yeah, a lot of scientists. Scientists, warmth is something that almost gets beaten out of us in graduate school. It's kind of like warmth, no. You have to be analytical. You have to be detached. You have to be cold, and the reason for that is we want to be unbiased. And if you're too warm, it almost works against your ability to be that that scientist that looks at the facts and treats them for what they are, not for what you want them to be. And so how do you turn the flip the switch? To flip the switch from, this is the scientist I am in the lab, and I just look at the evidence, and I read it for what it is. But then when I go out to the public, I show my warm and caring side as though I really do care about how the science impacts them. And I really do want to know what their issues are. And I want to connect to them. And so this is the difficulty. So how do we start by teaching our students and sort of training the students as and young professionals to be both the good scientist, so they're maxing out the competence scale, but then also maxing out the trustworthy scale by being able to flip that switch. And that's what the trick is.
Yeah, that's very important for us to remember. Something a little bit different, a question, which is that there's been different viewpoints on things like, for example, the March for Science, where some thought it was a very important opportunity to stand up for science, and others thought that it kind of politicized science and made it look like a rally and maybe even a partisan event. Yeah. Do you have views on that?
I think the first March for Science went really well. I think there were a lot of concerns that it might be overly partisan, but I didn't see a lot of that playing out. We had an open house at the National Academy that day that was totally facilitated by the rain, because all of these people came in because they had planned their picnics for that day. And we had all these rooms that were available for people to spread out on our big, you know, boardroom table and have their picnic lunches. And we had hot cocoa, and we had popcorn and cookies and stuff. And people came in with their signs, you know, like, save Mar-a-Lago, stop sea level rise, and stuff like that. And, you know, they were you know, mostly in jest, but not necessarily attacking, you know, in a mean way, the administration. And I think people were having a good time, and I don't know, so I thought it went well. Now, the second year, there just didn't seem to be as much energy in it. I don't know, but that was because maybe it was a sunny day, so people didn't come to the academy as much, but I don't know.
Ross, do we have? We have a question from Twitter. In the airplane smoking example, you noted the inclusion of expertise in airplanes along with health experts. Could you speak a little bit further to the role of including industries and regulated entities directly in research and synthesis? Come up a little bit in your example with the GMO, but...
Yes, so we actually don't include... So here's a good example. We recently put out a report on the resilience of the electrical grid. And this was a report that Congress was eagerly awaiting because of the concerns about hacking and the safety of the nation's electrical supply. And it was of concern not only for natural disasters, but also for because of the fact that there could be intentional disruption of our electrical supply by a foreign agent that might try to bring down you know, it wouldn't take too many major transformers coming down to overload all the others, and then you have a rolling blackout that start happening. And in fact, there were examples, I think, in the Ukraine where this started happening, and it was tied back to Russia. So we did a report on this, and the chair of the committee was concerned because we didn't have any existing grid operators on the committee. But we did put on a few people who were retired from the electrical grid sector, and were a few years out of it, but were no longer grid operators. So we felt they had the expertise, but didn't have the conflict of interest. So that's how we handle that. But we really feel that we can't have the conflict of interest of having people who are either regulators or from the industry currently on our committees.
Yep. Question about the proliferation of journals, scientific journals. And this question is particularly proliferation of dubious scientific journals with inadequate peer review. And a question about whether there's a role for the national academies to play in that, or how do we more generally deal with that in science?
So I received an email last week on Tuesday from Peter Raven, who is a former Home Secretary of the National Academy and should be familiar to resources from the future for the future, because he is a great botanist, former head of the Missouri Botanical Garden. He told me from his contacts in India that the Indian government has gone out to every university in India and asked them for their list of all of the predatory journals in India that the universities consider to be, have either peer review that they consider a sham, shoddy, or non-existent. And the government has said they are going to shut them down. And the email went on to say that they felt that it was the Indian government that inadvertently led to the rise of those journals by implementing a policy of promotion and tenure in India that counted peer review publications, and that led to the growth of all these journals. And so they decided that this had been a very bad thing, and they're going to shut them down. And I wrote Peter back right away, and I said, can they do that? We couldn't do that in the US. The UK couldn't do that. The EU couldn't do that. And Peter said, Peter wrote back to his friends in India and said, can the Indian government do that? And he said, yes, the Indian government can do it, the Chinese government can do it, and the Russian government can do it. And those are three governments that actually can do it. So there you go. That's
a good answer. This one is about how the to fully incorporate evidence into policymaking, you need policymakers who can do that. And so are there things that the National Academies or other institutions can do? So you might imagine electing scientists to public office, but and there may be some of them, but that's not going to be the full answer to the question. So are there things that,
some scientists are not necessarily great policymakers,
right,
so you have to find
warm.
The right ones. or they maybe aren't well suited to make decisions either. So
But still, science can be complex. And so are there things that, there's many different ways in which our policymakers can be, become acquainted with and educated around how evidence can be. So are there things that the National Academy does or other institutions can do to?
Yes, right. So we've had a lot of discussions about this at the National Academy, about having sort of a short kind of boot camp for new congressional representatives that come in. What has actually been most effective is just to informally offer to any person in government, whether they're an elected official, whether they're an appointed official, to convene experts on any topic at any time for any reason. And so it's just really an open invitation that we give. Like, we were over at an unnamed department of government the other day talking to them about a very sensitive topic, and we just said, let us know. We will pull together some experts from around the country to talk to you about this issue. It was an issue that was a classified topic, and we can get together people in our SCIF to talk to you about how to handle this. We probably need a week's notice to, get the right people in the room, but we can do that for you. And they recognized that they needed scientists to, help them understand what the possibilities were. And, so they were grateful. I think, though, that the challenge we're facing right now in this administration is that these people in government need to actually know when they have a science problem. And unless they have a scientist in the agency, they're unlikely to know that it actually is a science problem. So I think that's why it's really good to see that Kelvin Drogemeyer is about to be confirmed, you know, for OSTP, and we're hoping to get a scientist at Department of State for the science and technology advisor to the secretary. And, you know, they're starting to staff up with scientists in some of the other departments, because really, unless there is a scientist at the table, they just don't even know it's a science problem.
One of so I was involved in co-chairing a National Academy of Sciences committee on the social cost of carbon, which is the number the government and others use for assessing the damages from climate change. And one of the things we did after the report was finished was briefings on the Hill. I think we did, may have been like 15 different briefings with, mainly with congressional technical staff. And I found that be a very effective way to, inject in. And so often you know, decision makers are obviously very busy, and often they do rely on technical staff, as you're saying, to fully incorporate this.
Right.
So a question here about kind of the discomfort, I take it the discomfort that some scientists have in getting involved in policy stuff. And so it was a reaction to one of your points about policy without science is gambling. And what do you have to say? So this is really, I think, about how some scientists, I think maybe those, particularly if you're near policy circles and policy decisions, recognize that the importance of, becoming aware of and being engaged in policy, getting that evidence into the decision-making process. But there's many in academia who aren't comfortable with that, getting kind of near the policy process. So what do you say about that? Yeah.
So I'm probably an extreme in this, in terms of my view that, and I know other scientists are far over the line than I am. I feel that science should be policy relevant, but not policy prescriptive. So, and this is a holdover from my days at the USGS, where the USGS had to balance its science on the head of a pin. Because, you know, we would do, the USGS had an energy group, an ecosystems group, a climate group, and, you know, all of these groups had to understand that our science had to be absolutely neutral as to Department of Interior decisions on land use. And so we would provide the science, but not be prescriptive as to whether land would be used for energy development, for carbon sequestration, for grazing, for, you know, whatever. We would just say, if you do this, this would be the consequences. If you do that, these would be the likely consequences. This is what the science says, but we will not tell you what to do, because we understand that policymakers have to weigh all sorts of other issues. They have to weigh local values. They have to weigh economics. They have to weigh social issues. They have to weigh history. There are all sorts of things involved, and we're just the science part. Now, the science is very strong. The science is very predictive, and the science can say a lot. And the science can say, if you do this, this is likely to be the outcome. Are you going to be happy with that outcome? If not, you might not want to do that. But this is the way it is.
Thank you. Unless there's any other thoughts, I've been given the heads up that we're
out
of
people have to go, things to do. Yes, thank you. Thank you very much, Richard.
Thank you so much, Marcia McNutt.
Thank you.